Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. My name is Tehsin Abo Barirah, and today inshallah ta'ala I will be talking about the month of Safar, which has alhamdulillah started. The month of Safar, the second month of the Islamic calendar. It is the second today, if I'm not wrong, second of Safar, wallahu alam. So, the month of Safar, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us that this year started. The first month of the Islamic month is Muharram. And as we talked about Muharram last month, about the fazail, the virtues, the month of Safar has also virtues in itself. And inshallah ta'ala, I will be talking about some issues regarding the month of Safar, which many people believe in. There are superstitions, there are false misconceptions about the month of Safar, which I will be discussing, which I will be talking about today, inshallah ta'ala. So many people, very religious people also today, they have this misconception about the month of Safar. Many people don't know, but there are people who know, who say that this month is a month where we shouldn't have any nikah done, we shouldn't have any transaction done in this month because this month is unlucky. But this is a superstition, this is a wrong belief. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to tell us what is right and what is wrong. So the month of Safar is a month like other months. There is nothing unlucky in Islam, either place, or either person, or either numbers, or days, years. There is nothing which is unlucky, or which is which is dangerous for us. All these things has nothing to do with Islam. There are many superstitions people have, and in the time of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this month was regarded as an unlucky month. And Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam then said, "Wala Safar," that there is nothing wrong with the month of Safar. I will mention one hadith, inshallah ta'ala. The hadith starts with La Adwa Wala Tiyara. And there are a few things I will inshallah ta'ala discuss about, and I will be inshallah ta'ala mentioning regarding this hadith. The hadith is sahih, it is in Bukhari. La Adwa Wala Tiyarata Wala Hammata Wala Safar. That there is no contagiousness in diseases, no bad omens, no bad luck in an owl, and no bad luck in the month of Safar. So this hadith, La Adwa, Wala Tiyarata, Wala Hammata, Wala Safar, the first word, which is La Adwa. Allahu Akbar. Many people misunderstand this. Many people discuss this. Many people say that, na'udhu billah, we do not believe this part of the hadith, or it has to mean something else, because the medical science proves that one disease can transfer from one person to another person. So what does this hadith mean? La adwa wala la adwa. And then these people, they also say that, look, there is a hadith where is also from Bukhari, where Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Firra min al majdumi firaraka min al asad," that run away from a leper like you run away from a lion. Now, both hadith are sahih. La adwa is also sahih, and firra min al majdumi firaraka min al asad is also sahih hadith. And now, both of them contradicts each other. Now, ulama, we have to go back to ulama, muhaddithun, to ask them what is, how should we, which hadith should we practice upon, which hadith is right, which is wrong. But they say both are right. But what does this hadith mean, both of them? Then some ulama say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is two, three answers to combine both of these hadith, so that we, because we cannot deny either of them, because both are sahih, both comes from Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there is no doubt about it, and we cannot deny either the one or the second. So what does the combination of these two hadith mean? Or what is the meaning? What is the meaning we should have so that we can accept both of the hadiths? So one way is to say that أَنَّ هَذَا الْأَمْرَاضَ لَا تُعْدِي بِطَبْعِهَا, that the diseases are not transferable by itself. ولكن الله سبحانه وتعالى جعل مخالة المريض بها للصحيح سببا لإعدائه مرضه. Now I'm reading from a book which is called نزهة النظر, written by Allama Ibn Hajar Asqalani rahmatullah alayh, which is also taught in Madaris. Now he says that one tatbiq is what Ibn Salah rahmatullah alayhi says, that the diseases do not transfer by itself, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can make this disease which one person has as a sabab for another person. So it's not the other person, or is not the disease itself which is transferable by itself, but with the hukam, with the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it will be transferable. It will be contagious if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants. If Allah ta'ala doesn't want, it will not be. Now, reasons, they always change. وَثُمَّ قَدْ يَخْتَلِفُ ذَلِكَ عَنْ سَبَبِهِ كَمَا فِي غَيْرِهِ مِنَ الْأَسْبَابِ. Okay, so this is one explanation. But Ibn Hajar Asqalani rahimahullah ta'ala, he says that I think the best thing to say about these two hadiths, so we can understand both of them, is to say that anna nafyahu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam lil adwa baqin ala umumihi, that we should have our belief is that Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he says la adwa, when he is denying that there is no contagiousness in any illness, any disease, so it will be as Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said, that there is no contagiousness in any disease. Any disease is not transferable from one person or from one animal to another animal, from one person to another person, from one source to another source. وَقَدْ صَحَّ قَوْلُهُ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ لَا يُعْذِي شَيْءٌ شَيْئًا, and there is not only this hadith, there are other hadith also which says the same, that لا يُعْدِي شَيْءٌ شَيْءًا, that one disease is not transferable to another person, one thing is not transferable to another. وقوله صلى الله عليه وسلم لمن عارضه بأن البعير الأجرب يكون في الإبل الصحيحة فيخالطها فتجرب, حيث رد عليه بقوله فمن أعدى الأول, يعني أن الله سبحانه وتعالى ابتدأ بذلك في الثاني كما ابتدأه في الأول. Now, Allama ibn Hajar Asqalani rahimahullah ta'ala also explains that there is a hadith, some Sahaba ridwanullahi tajma'in, they were confused and then they came to ask Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that we see that one disease comes to one camel and it starts to get this kind of rash, and this rash is then transfers from one camel to the other camels. So we are confused, we want to ask. So Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam answered them, faman, Allahu akbar, faman a'da al-awwal, so where did this disease transfer from, you know, to the first one? From where did it come to the first camel? فَمَنْ أَعْدَ الْأَوَّلِ. So it was transferred from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is the creator of diseases, of illness. The illness comes also from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All good and evil is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now some people will say, astaghfirullah, Allah ta'ala have created the evil as well. The evil is created. And many of the evil actions and evil things and diseases and illnesses are created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but the mean of it is our bad actions. So because of our bad actions, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creates evil, which is then we are the sabab, we are the means of that. And sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created evil, has created illnesses, diseases. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to test us. And sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to get the daraja, get the grade, get the status of a pious, of a, you know, the great and status which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to give us, which we are not getting by our actions, by our a'mal, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to reach there. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then gives us ability and tawfiq to reach that status because of these illnesses, these diseases, these, you know, tests and imtihanat from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, what does Allama ibn Hajar Asqalani rahimahullah ta'ala say? La adwa, that Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, there is no contagiousness in illnesses. Illnesses do not transfer from one person to another person. And so, this is our belief. Now, what does this other hadith mean? وَأَمَّا الْأَمْرُ بِالْفِرَارِ مِنَ الْمَجْذُومِ فَمِنْ بَابِ سَدِّ الذَّرَائِعِ لِأَلَّا يَتَّفِقَ لِلشَّخْصِ الَّذِي يُخَالِطُهُ شَيْءٌ مِنْ ذَلِكَ بِتَقْدِيرِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى ابْتِدَاءً لَا بِالْعَدْوَى الْمَنْفِيَةِ فَيَظُنُّ أَنَّ ذَلِكَ بِسَبَبِ مُخَالِطَتِهِ فَيَعْتَقِدُ صِحَّةَ الْعَدْوَى فَيَقَعُ فِي الْحَرَجِ فأمر بتجنبه حسما للمادة والله أعلم. سبحان الله سبحان الله. The explanation given by Allama ibn Hajar Asqalani rahimahullah ta'ala is that why did the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam tell us to run away from a leper, from a majdhum, a person who has the illness of judham, like we, you know, keep us away from a dangerous animal like lion. And there is other ahadith also regarding a plague which has entered a town, a village, a place, ta'un. That Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's hidayat, he has told us that if a plague enters into a village, into a place, a town, that those people who are living there should not go out from that town, and people living outside that town shouldn't visit that town until the plague has, you know, finished or gone away. Allahu Akbar. So that hadith and this hadith where Prophet ﷺ says, keep yourself away, run away. He doesn't say keep you away, run away, like you run away from a lion, is because, Allahu Akbar, if this person gets the same illness, if this person, he gets the same illness, he also gets judham. A person who came to a town where it was a plague going on, and he was caught in this plague, in this disease, in this illness, what will he think? What will he say? What will his belief be? That I became ill because of that person. I became ill because of this plague. If I wouldn't have come here, I would have been all right. I would have been okay. So, Allahu Akbar. Now, to safeguard his iman, to safeguard his aqeedah, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is advising, keep yourself away. Because the giver of life and death, the giver of health and wealth and diseases and illnesses is only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, a person who will get illness, it is possible that he will, you know, refer to this person, and maybe hatred can create because of this, maybe fights can start because of this, and that is all law in the eye of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, according to the aqeedah, the belief which comes number one, which can also be affected, can be changed, that because of this illness he may pass away with the aqeedah, na'udhu billah, that look, I became ill because of this person. So his connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be disturbed, because whatever halat, whatever conditions come upon us, we should always believe and think that it came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because this is the reality. Everything comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But nowadays it's so common to say, yes, I got the flu because my brother, he was also sneezing, he had flu, and I caught it from him. Very easy to say these things, and it's very common that everyone says that. But we shouldn't say that, because la adwa wa la tiyarata fil Islam. We do not believe this. Allahu Akbar. But obviously, according to the understanding of Quran and Hadith, one disease which happened to be a illness which happened to be in a person, it can transfer if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants, because in itself it's a, you know, jarathim, bacteria, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created, which travel, with the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it can come from one person to another person or directly to a person. It is the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nothing can happen without the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So anyhow, all this discussion happened because of this hadith, لا عدوى ولا طيرة ولا هامة ولا صفر. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward Allama ibn Hajar Asqalani rahmahullah ta'ala for mentioning this hadith. And we can learn two things from this. One, the mas'ala we learned, and one that, look, there can be two hadiths, both of them are sahih, both of them are mentioned in Bukhari, in fact. And if we read one hadith, we see that this hadith is contradicting the other hadith. So which one should we choose? Which one is the right? Which one is wrong, when we know both are right? So that's why we are in need of going to ulama, muhaddithun. We cannot understand Islam by ourselves, because our lack of knowledge will lead us to astrayness. We will be led to something else. We will misunderstand and then fall to dalal, to gumrahi, and be astray. So that's why it's very important. فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Today as well, we see on TV as well that people, and obviously shaitan is working, he is promoting those people who do not have the knowledge of Islam. They haven't learned the usul of Quran and hadith in the traditional way, which has been taught from the time of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam to Sahaba, from Sahaba to Tabi'un, from Tabi'un to Taba Tabi'in, and so on till today, alhamdulillah. Today, those people who have studied in Madaris, they have a chain of transmissions which leads from the person to Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Each and every hadith which we have read, alhamdulillah, in Bukhari, in Muslim, in Tirmidhi, in Abu Dawood, and other many other books, it leads to Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So, but there are people who have not studied Islam, or there are many ulama also, mashallah, but tell you something about Quran and Hadith, and if they are going against the majority of ulama's understanding or in a matter, then we keep quiet, or the ulama, obviously it's ulama's job to tell us to follow them or not to follow them. And in every law school, in every group in this world, there are many ulama, mashallah, who have, you know, tafarrudat. They have their own ideas about certain masail. We respect that, but we follow the majority. I'll just give you one example. Like the majority of us who will be listening on the radio as well are following Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah ta'ala, the Hanafi law school. And many people, they do not have enough knowledge, ilm regarding this as well. They don't know what we are following. Are we not following Quran and Hadith? Of course we are following Quran and Hadith, but it's a system of understanding, because in Quran and Hadith, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Quran, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ, that ask those who have knowledge if you do not have the knowledge. So in fiqh, we follow Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullahu ta'ala, and in masail. But there are so many masail, there are so many things which were said by Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullahu ta'ala, but the Hanafi law school, the Hanafi followers do not follow his view today, because the majority of his students, the majority of ulama of Ahnaf, and when I say majority, I mean the muhakkikun, those with really deep knowledge of Islam, of fiqh, when majority of them do not follow Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah ta'ala, then we follow them. So, but this is not the time of discussing this, because I need to then explain many other things which I haven't prepared for as well. So let us go and finish the today's lesson, which is about the month of Safar. And Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says in this hadith which I mentioned, لا عدوى ولا طيرة ولا هامة ولا صفر, that there is, regarding Safar, there is no bad luck in the month of Safar. And likewise, you know, sometimes people say, oh, a black cat just crossed the road and something bad will happen to me. Some people, they think that if a cat is meowing in the night, it may be meowing because of its mating, but is meowing in the night, oh, someone will die. Some of my beloved will die because we heard a cat meowing. So all these things are superstitions. These has nothing to do with Islam. And thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, alhamdulillah, that we don't have any things like that. But just imagine if this was a reality in Islam, that a cat meowed and something bad will happen, then how depressing that would be. That we will be thinking, oh, whose turn is it? Who's going to die now? What bad will happen to me? And then if something happens, then we say, oh, it happened because of this and this. And then a person's disbelief just gets stronger. So may Allah Ta'ala safeguard our iman. The most valuable thing in Islam is iman. Without iman, there is no Islam. You can be praying salah and giving zakat and doing good actions, but if your iman is not right, if there is a slightly doubt you have in your iman, then you don't have iman. Na'uz billah. A person believes in whole Quran, in all the qualities of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but one ayat he doesn't believe. How can he be a Muslim? Let me just give you an example. He believes in everything except that Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is the final prophet. Na'udhu billah. He believes in everything except this verse. Or a person, he believes in everything except of one quality of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then how can this person become a Muslim? He is not a Muslim. Although he prays, although he has a big beard, although, you know, he looks very pious, he wears a turban, he is not a Muslim. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clearly says in Quran, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. And then Allah Ta'ala says, ثُمَّ لَمْ يَرْتَابُ, that after iman, they don't have any doubts. So all these things, all these superstitions will create doubts in us. Allahu Akbar. So the stars, all these are creations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It has nothing to do with our qismat, our qadr. We believe in fate. Good and bad is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-qadr khayrihi wa sharrihi min Allah ta'ala wal-ba'thi ba'd al-maut. We believe in the qadr. We believe in taqdeer. Whatever a person, for example, he commits suicide, now he dies or she dies. It was written by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The time of death and time of life, these things are written by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, the sabab, the mean he chose or she chose was haram, and he and she had the qudrat, the what do you call it, the ikhtiyar from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah ta'ala gave them ability to choose the right or the wrong, and they chose the wrong action. Like a person, he steals and he gets 100 pounds. He steals 100 pounds. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had written these 100 pounds for him, but he chose to get these 100 pounds by stealing, by sin. So he will get the sin. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had already written these 100 pounds for him. So why did he choose to get these 100 pounds by lying, by stealing, by fraud? So this is the test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah ta'ala is testing our iman, our belief. When we believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will test us to see, does he or she really have iman, or is it just, you know, in the mouth, in just saying? Is it in the heart or only in the mind? Allahu Akbar. And these kind of doubts then will just, you know, keep on creating more doubts. And a person will, you know, start thinking, oh, this bad thing happened to me. It is because somebody has done evil eye upon me. Now, evil eye, there is a misconception there as well. Evil eye, nazar, in Arabic and also in Urdu and in Gujarati as well, we say nazar. Allah Ta'ala, Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has said, an-nadharu haqq, that evil eye is a truth. It is a fact. It happens. Now we have to understand that evil eye does not mean that a person deliberately, intentionally is, you know, giving you evil eye. Because evil eye happens, it could be your own evil eye. You saw your own child, and you know, you got really happy. Oh, such a beautiful, my child is, he's so clever. And then this could be the cause of them getting nazar, and now they are behaving a bit strange. And this is very natural. I think, wallahu alam, 60, 70, 80% of the evil eye is from our, you know, own family, from our own, you know, father, mother, sister, and without any bad intention. We don't have any bad intention. That's why when we see something good, we should say MashaAllah. We should say MashaAllah. And inshallah ta'ala, hopefully this will prevent the evil eye. And that's why if we have a doubt that my kid is, you know, acting a bit strange, then we should try to recite the last verse of Surah Qalam. There are many other du'as also mentioned in Quran, mentioned in Hadith, which we should choose to recite and read ourselves, and we should learn this. You don't need to go to a Maulana always, or to a Amil always, and you know, for small things, or I'm seeing this, I'm doing this, I'm... We have Quran, alhamdulillah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taught us Quran, and we should read it, we should learn it. And we, mashallah, we should spend some time. You don't want to do anything yourself, you know, just the easy way out by, you know, calling one Maulana or one Hafizab, come and help me. And obviously, they have other things to do as well. And then if they're going to spend their time in these things, then obviously you are taking their time. And one time you can do it for free, you know, second time, but... And there is nothing wrong. Many people, they go to these amils and they say, you know, I went to this amil. He's very good and he is free of charge. He doesn't charge anything. So we think, because he is not charging anything, it is a dalil, it is a proof that he is right. Subhanallah. What kind of proof is this? What kind of decision is this? Subhanallah. And a person who is charging, he's just fraud. Na'uzubillah. Allahu Akbar. Just remember the hadith. I don't have much time left. I just remember a hadith in Tirmizi. I don't remember the full hadith, so I will just mention the parts which I remember. That the Sahaba, they were on a journey. This hadith is mentioned in Tirmidhi. This is what I remember, inshallah. The group of Sahaba were traveling, and they went in a place, and people there were really stingy. In that time, the culture was, whenever you see some strangers, you always help them, you always give them some food. You know, it was a culture. But anyway, these people, they were really stingy. They didn't help the Sahaba. And Sahaba, they were doing sabr. They didn't ask for anything and they said, Tawakkal Allah. What happened was, their leader, he became ill. He became so ill that they were fearing that he might die. So they said, you know, there is a group of stranger people and they look pious people, ask them. So when they came to ask the Sahaba, one Sahabi, he said that, yes, I can read something and I can guarantee that he will become, he will get cure, but I have some condition. And then he said that I want so much. It was in form of, if I remember right, he wanted, he said that I'll take some animals if he gets better. So the Sahabi, he went, he read something, and then they took all these animals. Maybe it was, lamb, sheep, something like that. And when they came to Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, then the Sahabi, he thought, we should have asked Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, is it halal for us or not? Then Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam asked, tell me, what did you read? He said, you have taught us to read Surah Al-Fatiha. So I read Surah Al-Fatiha and Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala gave him shifa. And now I want to ask, is these animals halal for us or not? And Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, nearest meaning of the hadith, that give some to me as well. So it clearly, is a proof that it's nothing wrong to help people. The amils, they help people and then they take, money for their time, for the expenses. There is nothing wrong with that. And as well, we have mashallah Qari Hazrat, we have Nasheed programmers who do these programs, and obviously they are doing this for full time, and then there is nothing wrong within the limits, obviously, within the sharaat and hukuk and hudud. Is very hukuk and hudud, it's very important to not to go over the hudud. So I will end my talk today, inshallah ta'ala. So today's talk was regarding this month of Safar. There is nothing bad luck in this month of Safar. There is nothing wrong with many people that don't do nikah in this month. There is nothing wrong. In fact, a person who does his nikah in this month will get more reward, inshallah ta'ala, because he is, what is he doing? He's showing that this is a false misconception and a superstition to believe that this month is an unlucky month. It's not an unlucky month. In fact, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam got married with one of his wives in this month of Safar. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us ability and tawfiq and safeguard our iman, and ability and tawfiq to safeguard our iman, to increase our iman, and then when we die with the kalima, with the right belief, لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.